Praise God. Hallelujah. We thank God for the spirit of intercession. Just a strong, strong grace. We thank God for his presence here today. And we thank God for you. We want to welcome you on behalf of our senior leaders, Apostle Rod and Prophetess Selena Stevenson. We say God bless you and thank you for joining us here at the Rivers of Living Water Ministries International Muskegon location. We're so glad that you joined us here today, and we are so grateful to be able to worship the Lord with you. We just want to invite you to partner with us. We always want to just say a word of thanks for all of you who have been so generous and you have been so faithful in contributing to the ministry. But we want to invite you who have not, or maybe you have just maybe been a little hesitant. We want to invite you to partner with this ministry. This is good ground. You're sowing into good ground. And so we want to invite you to sow a seed today, to give a generous donation to our ministry. You can give by using our text to give platform. And I'll give you that number. That number is area code 231-221-2160. So text the word give and a dollar amount to 231-221-2160. You may also send your generous donation by mail by making a check or money order payable to ROLWMI. The mailing address is 1550, that's 1550 East Laketon Avenue in Muskegon, Michigan, and the zip code is 49442. Saints, we want to say thank you. God bless you. We speak blessing into your home. We speak blessing into your families, over your families. We speak blessing upon your children, upon your bodies, and especially in this season, we say God bless you. Right now, we want you to join us. Join alongside our worship team as we go before the Lord and give him praise as we honor him and worship him. Right after our worship presentation, prepare your hearts and get ready for the word of God. It's going to stir you. It's going to motivate you. It's going to challenge you, but it will also equip you. God bless you.
Hallelujah. We are so glad that you would join us on this morning and just giving all the glory and all the honor and all the praise unto our God. Because surely he is worthy of the glory. Come on, just right there where you are in your home, just begin to lift up your hands. But don't just lift up your hands, lift up your heart. Huh? Come on and just lift up your heart unto our God and let the glory rise. Come on, we're going to cry out on this morning. We're crying out for the glory of our God. We need the glory of our God. We need the glory of our God. We need his weighty presence in the earth right now. Hallelujah. I just believe that you need his weighty presence right now. Hallelujah. Right where you are. Come on, just begin to beckon. He is El Hakabah. He is the God of glory. And we want his glory to rise in the midst of us. Let the whole earth be filled with your glory, God. Let the whole earth be filled with your glory, God. We want the whole earth to be filled with your glory, God. Hallelujah. Let it rise. Let it rise. Come on, let it rise. As our praises fill the sky, let it rise, let it rise. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Let it rise, let it rise.
As our praises,
as our praises,
come on, fill it up.
Fill the sky.
Let it rise,
let it rise,
let it rise. Hallelujah,
let it rise.
Hallelujah,
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 hallelujah.
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 Come on and fill the earth as we give you praise, as we sing your name.
praises rise. Let your glory rise as our praises rise.
Welcome back to the broadcast tonight. My name is Marla McCreary, and I'm so excited that you decided to sup with us and to spend time in the word of the Lord, because if there's ever a time where we would need the word of the Lord, we know it is right now on this planet called Earth. And so I'm so excited as we begin to fellowship and sup in God's word, because we know that the word brings about edification and comfort and joy and anointing and building and purging and correction. Everything that we have need of, we can find it in God's word. Amen. So I'm excited that you're here. And so we're just going to invite the presence of the Holy Spirit. But also, I want to take advantage of the opportunity to just give honor to Apostle Rod and Prophetess Selena Stevenson. I'm so excited and so looking forward to what the Lord has in store for them. So I lose blessings upon them, and just even just thanking the Lord for them in our lives. And so I appreciate you. I love you. And I just want you to be blessed in the city and blessed in the field. And so, Body of Christ, Rivers of Living Water Ministry International, those of you who are viewing, my family, I want to give honor to my husband and also to my parents and my family, my children, my grandchild. Everybody is special in the kingdom of God. Amen. So we're going to pray, and then we're just going to get right into the lesson tonight. Amen. And so, Holy Spirit, we just thank you for your presence. We just thank you for the lessons. We thank you for the word of the living God. We thank you for the strategia in this hour that you have equipped us with. We thank you for the believer's authority. We thank you for the weapons of our warfare that are not carnal, but they are mighty through you to the pulling down of every stronghold. And so, Holy Spirit, we just partner with you. We submit ourselves and we yield ourselves unto your spirit, unto your tutelage. And so we thank you that our ears will hear what your spirit is saying, and we were to put into practice, Father God, what you've already told us according to your word. And so tonight I just thank you and bless you, Father, in Jesus' name. And so, for those of you who don't know, this is lesson two of a new series that we began entitled The Believer's Authority. And believers need to believe that they have authority. They need to understand that we have authority. We need to activate and operate in our authority. And so the title of tonight's lesson is Whom He May Devour. Whom He May Devour. And so let's just visit, who is he in that phrase and in that title? Well, I'm going to tell you. I'm glad you asked that question. So he is referring to Satan, the devil, the wicked one, the deceiver, the father of lies, the tempter, the thief, the murderer, the accuser, the enemy, the adversary. He is an adversary to us. And so when it talks about devour, that word just means to consume hungrily, aggressively, ravenously, ferociously, destructively. And when you think about an animal, a predatory animal, and how it sets its sights upon its prey, it studies its prey, and it has an appetite for that prey. It seeks out that prey. It watches to see if there's any ailment in that prey. And so they size up prey, and they look to see whom they can devour. And so a lot of times the enemy may rest, or even like in the kingdom of the animal kingdom, they study, they rest, and they look to see who's not flowing or running, who's not healthy, who's not running with the pack. And they are seeking who they can devour. And so we have to understand that just like a natural enemy or foe, a predator-prey situation, it's the same thing in the spirit realm. And so we have to understand the enemy's plan is to steal, kill, and destroy, just like the word of the Lord says. And so we have to understand that we are in a battle, and our enemy, even though he's a defeated foe, he's still a very cunning and strategic foe. And so we have to understand his tactics, his MO, his devices. The word says we should not be ignorant of his devices, because in a war, and if you have not known that or come to the understanding, yes, we are in a war. We are in a battle, but it is a battle that is fixed and already been won by the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. And so even though it's been won, even though Jesus made an open show and an open spectacle of our enemy, we trample under our feet, we still have to fight the good fight of faith in this battle. So we have to know we're in a battle, and so we have to be equipped. We have to understand tactics. And the reason that's important, because just like in a natural battle, you have a team and they strategize in a war situation. And so you have two opposing teams and they develop plans and strategies. They size up their enemy. They know the enemy's flaws and proclivities and things of that nature. And so just like in a natural battle, you have to understand what weapons the other side may have. You know, so we have to understand that, so that we don't become a casualty of war. We have to understand where there might be booby traps and where there might be landmines. Amen. So it's the same thing, weapons of mass destruction, the same thing in the spirit realm. And so in this battle, which is not a physical battle or a physical war, but it's a spiritual one. And so there are some things that we can do that will enhance the battle to speed and expedite the battle. There are some things that we can do, some actions we can take to ensure that we come out on top, that we come out in a place of victory. And so really what that looks like is that in this spiritual battle between the kingdom of light, the kingdom of our God, and the enemy, the kingdom of darkness, in this battle, in this war that's taking place, whatever we yield to, whatever we submit to, whatever decision we make outside of the plan, the strategy of heaven, the 66 books of God's word, whatever we do, submit to, compromise in, overlook, or don't pay attention to, when we do those things, we are causing either the kingdom of God to be increased or the kingdom of the enemy to be increased. And so it's a classic scripture, or not scripture, but even the proverb, I think it's an Indian proverb, that says the battle is between two kingdoms, it's between two wolves, and whatever wolf you feed is a wolf that's going to grow. And so scriptorally, we know that that reference about who you yield to is found in Romans 6 and 16. And it reads, "Know you not that to whom you yield yourselves, servants to obey, his servants ye are, to whom you obey, whether of sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness." So it's telling us in this battle, the decisions you make or don't make, the obedience you operate in or don't operate in, the thought posture that you think or don't think, the action that you take or don't take, who you yield to is either going to be unto sin or either unto righteousness. And so that's what the scripture is telling us. In this battle, whoever you yield to, you are giving them lordship and even causing them to be servant or uplifted in your life. You have given them a position in your life. And so we want to make sure that we are not giving the enemy any ground, because he likes to have a legality to come in. And so we have to understand that our obedience is key. And so even the apostle spoke that in this season going forward, that it's our obedience that's going to help us to be victorious. And so we can't afford to lose any ground. We can't afford to lose any soldiers. We can't afford to be casualties of war. We can't afford to cause the battle to be turned except at the gate of our mouth and confession, except by the way we live and make choices and what we yield to. Remember, when we submit and yield to God, we strengthen that fight. We fight with angelic forces. When we yield to and obey him, it gives him permission. And when we don't, it gives the enemy position to come in. And so we have to understand what we yield to is who is being fed, who is going to grow, who's gaining ground. And so when we yield ourselves to sin, you're literally serving Satan. You're making him your Lord and your master, because he's the author of sin. And so if you yield to him, how can you not have sin-stained garments? Because he is the master of sin, the father of sin. And so when we yield to sin, we serve Satan. When we yield to righteousness, we serve the living God. And so we have to understand this. God is the author of righteousness. And so we have to have a right perception. We have to have a right mindset. We have to have right actions, right weapons in order to fight this fight. And so we won't accomplish what God has ordained for us to accomplish if we are sitting on the sidelines. We won't accomplish what God has for us if we don't know how to fight. And I'm just going to be honest, in the world, I was not a fighter. But when I came into the kingdom of God, you have to know how to fight. You know, I know some people think about, I'm going to put my hair up, I'm going to put some Vaseline on my face. They know and they think about what I'm going to use as a weapon. You know, so we have to understand the same in the kingdom. We know how to fight, and we don't fight with our fists. It's not a flesh and blood fight, but we fight by how we respond. We fight by how we live. Whew, I'm going to say that again. We fight by how we live every day. And I was talking to Prophetess Selena last night, and we were talking about how in this hour, it's our obedience is so key, what we yield to, because you might only have a few seconds, she was saying, to make the right choice. So we have to understand, we have to yield to obedience to where it becomes like first nature, not second nature, but it's just innate on the inside of us. And that takes practice. That takes yielding our members unto the Holy Spirit. Amen. So that we can accomplish his purposes and his will in the earth. And so we can't afford to be led by our flesh. We can't afford to be angry and mess up our witness and crucify Jesus all over again. We can't afford to strengthen the enemy saying and mocking. I see they weren't saved. They aren't Christian. We can't afford to let the reputation of Christ be spotted, wrinkled, or blemished, or tarnished. We can't afford it. So we have no choice to operate. There are souls attached to our obedience and what we yield to. Our children, our children's children, we cannot afford to yield. And we think sometimes that because we are forgiven, because God is a forgiving God, because he doesn't come right away with a recompense, and sometimes it's not really even him. We know a good father corrects his children, but when you yield to Satan, you have given him obeisance to come in and bring about whatever consequence that he wants to. So we have to understand obedience is key and it's crucial. And so understanding also that we can't do anything in our flesh, because the word says that our flesh is at war against God. So we can't operate in anger and wrath and bitterness and unforgiveness and offense. We can't afford to cause the enemy to have that weapon in our life. And so we have to understand that when we are operating those things, it's from the kingdom of our carnality. It's from the kingdom of our sinful earthly nature. Excuse me. And so the reference, James 3 and 16 says, we're envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. So we have to understand when our heart isn't right, when we're envious of what we think we don't have or what we think we want, then about it says that then there's you're confused and it brings about more confusion and every evil work. And so we have to understand that in this fight that we're fighting, we are either giving off a sweet aroma in the nostrils of Christ, or we are spiritually stinky. And I don't know about you, but I want to be a fresh fragrance. I want my obedience to please him. And without faith, it's impossible to please him. And so it takes faith to obey him. And I want to make sure that I am sending up a fragrance that is pure in his nostrils, that my obedience is causing there to be a fresh scent on a summer's day when you just get finished cleaning your house, a fresh scent, because that's attractive. When somebody smells good, that's attractive. When they are stinky, it's repelling. So we have to understand what we yield to causes a scent. And we want the Holy Spirit, the fragrance of our obedience, the fragrance of our worship, the fragrance of our yielding to the word of the living God. We want that to be the aroma that comes up before the Lord. Amen. We don't want, you know, it's no fun being around somebody that smells, especially when you're stuck and can't get away. Maybe you're on a bus or something like that. It's no fun. So we want to make sure we don't want to smell or cause offense or odor. And so moving forward, we have to understand that our thoughts, our attitude, words, and actions are either releasing the power of God in our life or they are releasing the power of the devil. And so that's just a strategy right there. You know, it's kind of saying the same thing over, but we need to make sure we get it. Repetition can be a great teacher. So what you think about, what you ponder, what's in your heart, envying, strife, jealousy, any of those kind of things, what you yield to, you're going to either release the power of God in your life or the power of the devil. You're going to release blessing or you're going to release curses. You're going to release breakthrough or you're going to release delay. And so we have to understand that And God is just, he's good, and he's good all the time, and he wants us to be blessed. He gives good gifts to his children. And so we have to understand that's the reason why he told us to obey. It's not because he wanted to be a dictator and control everything that we do, but he understands that whatever we yield to is going to be strengthened. And so that's why he gave us the 66 books. And a lot of people don't understand that. They think, I'm not going to be able to have any fun. I can't do this. I can't do that. But no, you don't get to do that so that you can be safe and protected in his pavilion. So it's all about perception and how we look at things. And so God is good and he wants good for us. But the enemy, the one called the devourer, we are warned in the scripture, we are encouraged rather. 1 Peter 5:8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about looking for whom he may gobble up and just destroy. He's looking for whom he may destroy, utterly destroy. And so we have to be sober-minded. And when I think about somebody who is intoxicated, when you're intoxicated, you are not at your best. You leave yourself wide open. And that's why the enemy comes and he studies to see if you're intoxicated instead of sober, because he knows that you are let your guard down and you're really kind of uninhibited. And so you don't have your best mindset on. You can't make rational decisions. You can't be led by the Spirit. So that's why he says, be sober-minded, not emotionally high-strung, not doing things from 0 to 100 without thinking a thing and a matter out. And so the word says to be sober and be vigilant, because this adversary is diligent. He is relentless. And he studies us, and he spends time, and he looks to see who's maimed. He looks to see who is not healthy. So we have to be sober-minded. We have to stay with the pack. And so we have to understand that Satan wants to devour us. But the one key that the lesson tells us is that he cannot devour us apart from our cooperation. He cannot devour us apart from our yielding ourselves to him to give him access to come in. He cannot do it. So that's why we are to remain focused, remain vigilant, remain sober-minded, remain obedient, so that he cannot come in and not have access and not devour us. God says he rebukes the devourer predicated on our obedience. Amen. And so one of the strategies to make sure that we're not cooperating with Satan is to set a watch before our mouth. You know, sometimes you have to examine, going back to what we think and our actions, sometimes you just need to change your thinking. Your thinking can be stinking. When we were talking about odors and those kind of things, sometimes what we are meditating on, that's why the word says renew your mind. Have a different mindset. Come up higher in your thinking. Think like God thinks. God does not think defeat. God does not think, oh, what am I going to do? God does not think I don't have a plan B. He is the creator of all plans. And so we have to understand that. We need to make sure we have to understand what comes out of our mouth enhances either God's kingdom, even as a word, or even the kingdom of the devil. And Psalms 103:20 says, bless the Lord, you his angels who excel in strength, who do his word. Listen to this. Hearkening unto the voice of his word. And so we have to understand that one of the reasons in this battle to not give the enemy access is to watch what we say. Because when you say something, that's one thing I used to always love about the gift of praying in the Holy Spirit. It's because the enemy doesn't know what frequency you're on. He doesn't know what you're saying. And a lot of times when we say something in the natural, the enemy is coming from those words. And so at the same time, angels are coming for God's word. And so that's why the scripture says, watch what you say, because if you speak God's word, the angels hearken to that word. So that's the key in this battle. Watch what you say. Sometimes it's not even necessary that you have anything to say. There's many scriptures that talk about just being wise, or even being perceived as wise. It's the fool. Everybody will know a person is a fool by when they open their mouth. Sometimes you just need to sit back and watch. Be sober-minded. and figure out and inquire a little what your strategy is going to be. And so sometimes it just requires, not everything requires a word or a response. But when it does, let it be spirit-led by the Spirit of the living God. Amen. That's a strategy in the battle, to watch what you say. We also need to have control over our actions, because our actions affect people, situations, destiny. Our actions affect destiny. And so we have to understand and recognize that there is a demonic realm, and the enemy is trying to take shots and throw darts at us every day. But thanks be unto God, who always causes us to triumph as we yield to him, as we submit to God. Resist that devil, and the devil has to flee. And he'll come for a more opportune time. But you have to be like Jesus. He was in a place of fasting. He spoke the word. He didn't speak contrary, so the angels could come for that word. And it even came to minister to him after he spoke the word, because he said, it is written. He spoke the word as a strategy. So we have to understand, when we do speak, it had better be the books of the law. It had better be the living word, which is active and does not return to him void. So we have to understand and recognize the spiritual dynamics that are taking place in our life. What we say matters. What we don't say matters. How we act matters. You know, you can't be on the job blowing up, breaking your witness. You can't be in a restaurant, where we can't right now anyway, but you can't be rude to your server. You know, we have to understand people are always watching, just like the kingdom of darkness is always watching. So we have to understand, we have to submit and yield to God, so that the enemy's influence is bound. Amen. And we don't want sin to be conceived because of our emotions. We have to understand our emotions like to lead us astray. So that's why the word says be sober. And so we have to not be in a place of just acting before thinking. So that's a strategy. And so, you know, things come up, you know, situations happen, people push our buttons. The enemy loves to push our buttons, but the fruit of the Spirit, we're going to talk about that, the place of control is a strategy. And so we have to understand that James verses 1, chapter 1, verses 14 through 15, James chapter 1, 14 through 15, it talks about in this battle and in life, everybody gets tempted. Everybody does. Mother Teresa, Catholic nuns, priests, everybody gets tempted. But the strategy is to understand when we're tempted, when we're drawn away because of our own lust, what's already in our hearts, and when we're enticed, we're given lust the permission to be born and conceived, and it'll bring forth a life. It'll bring forth destiny. It'll bring forth sin. And sin, when it's finished, brings forth death. So we have to understand, yes, you're going to be tempted, but don't yield to the temptation. And we know we mess up. There's grace for that. But you have to have that sober-mindedness to think about the choice and the consequence that will come and is attached to that choice. So we have to understand, everybody gets tempted. Jesus was tempted, but he understood, I cannot yield to that. He was an example so that we knew that if he did it, that we could do it. So not yielding unto the temptation. Yes, there's sometimes you might want to eat that cake, that second piece. You don't have to yield to it. You know, there's strategy on things that we can do. So we have to understand that. And so when we have emotions and are led astray by those negative emotions, anger, fear, strife, then things are going to be conceived. So we can't afford to give the enemy access to blow up and to multiply and to grow. And so that's why we have to make sure our actions, our thoughts are in alignment with what God's saying. Because going back to that battle, whatever we yield to is going to be strengthened. And so we have to understand the nature of a thief. And I'm going to talk about the popular scripture we quote, John 10 and 10. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life. I am come that they may have life. He came so that you may have life. I am come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. And so I want to talk about the nature of a thief. The other day I was watching a crime show, and it was a true story. And it was this couple and their two children who were accosted by some two thieves that broke into their home. Now, it actually, they had two different occurrences to where their house was broken in, because the thieves knew exactly what they were looking for, predicated on the man kind of was on his, like, social media, and he was just gave out too much information, doing too much talking, like the scripture tells us, to put a mutter, to silence what we say. It's a bridle, I believe it is. Thank you, Holy Spirit. And so he had come into an insurance settlement, and so he had a nickname for being called the bread man, because he liked to deliver bread in the natural as something just to bless his neighborhood. But he also, when he came into that money, somebody knew about it, and somebody was either talking or watching his page. The detectives kind of put that together after the fact. And so here these people are in their own home, and you get these two people who come into your territory, your safe place. And it was so sad, because they had the man laying down on his stomach without a place to fight back, because they're holding these two automatic weapons. And they even had the babies out there that made me so mad, you know, that the enemy does not think even about your precious, what's precious to you. And so what happened was they kept saying, where's the money? Where's the money? And the husband, of course, he didn't want to give it up, and he wouldn't release it. And finally the wife says, okay, I'll tell you where it is. So she goes to her safe and gave them $30,000. They had more of settlement, but that was what they had on their person and their home. She gave them the $30,000. She gave them most of her good jewelry. She gave them even a gun. And do you know that was not enough? I said, what kind of audacity is that for the thief to say, give me your stuff, $30,000. She didn't give you $30,000. But a thief does not care. It wants to steal, kill, and destroy, and rob, and ingest ravenously everything that it can consume or devour. And it just made me so mad. It's like, wow, you gonna take their stuff. That's what a thief wants to do. You didn't came in their house. They didn't give you all this stuff, and you not satisfied. You want more. That's what a thief wants. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And so we can't yield to that. We have to understand the enemy wants to devour our prized possessions, but we can't give them to him and let him know. We have to stay under the pavilion and protection of the Holy Spirit, because God says, I want you to have life, and I want you to have it abundantly. That's why he came. And so that is a strategy. We have to understand what the purpose of God is, and understand what the purpose of the enemy. We don't want him to steal from us. We don't want him to kill our dreams. We don't want him to kill our destiny, because we've yielded to him. So we have to understand the nature of a thief. The Lord wants to give us life, and life with an advantage. Amen. It's something about an advantage. It tips the scales. And we see it every day. We have that thing called favor upon our life. And it's a blessing. You see God giving us that abundant life. I mean, it's there. I was talking to Sister Ashley, and we were talking about how 2020, we know the positives and negatives, but she did something I thought was so powerful. She said to make her mindset stay in a place of sobriety, she was not going to prophesy all of the things that have been rehearsed about 2020. And so I think she said she actually made herself a jar. And in the jar, she began to write down the goodness and the blessing of the Lord that had occurred. And I thought that was so powerful, just to recognize and remember what the Lord has done. And so that's the key. You know, God has given us life. He's given us blessings upon blessing. And so we have to understand our thoughts, our choices, and actions can make a huge difference in our life. And so how you see a thing can make a huge difference in our life. How we meditate, how we view, how we preview, how we think upon a thing can have a major impact. And so it's going to the place of what we yield to, even in our thoughts. Amen. We're told to take authority over our thoughts. Since we're talking about the believer's authority, take authority over what you're saying. Take authority over what you're doing. Take authority over how you're living. Take authority over what you're yielding to. Amen. And so we know the devil is the one who wants envy and strife to break out of confusion and every evil work. And so this is so key. It says he is as a roaring lion, but he's not actually really one. Jesus is the lion. Jesus is the one that has the roar you know, R-O-A-R. So the scripture says he likes to mock, and he likes to imitate, rather. And so it says, as a lion. A lot of times, prey will fall into a place of being paralyzed or fear just because of the roar. And so we have to understand the enemy, he's barking. He's done some things in this pandemic, but is as a lion. He cannot hurt us. He cannot harm us as we submit to God and resist him. He has to flee. He's not a lion. He's not a lion of the tribe of Judah. He just wants to be in that place of authority, but he is not an authority we are. He's not an authority you are. So understand, he is as a lion. And so we're just about finished. I'm just going to revisit some scriptures that were in the lessons. I know it was kind of short and sweet, but maybe you can go back and visit the broadcast. And I know in the chat there's going to be these scriptures as I release them, but if you miss them, please go back and visit. And so talking about being devoured, these are some scriptures. James 1:20 says, for the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. So we have to understand that if we are in our flesh, going back to that point, if we are in a place of wrath and anger, there's no righteousness of God that's going to be able to manifest. And so God's kingdom will not be abundant. God will not be enhanced in the earth if we try to operate in our flesh with a wrath and an anger. Only God has he said, be angry, but don't sin. We don't have time to be holding on to wrath. God said, vengeance is mine. So we can't let wrath and emotions cause us to yield to that temptation. Amen. Everybody's tempted, remember, but we can't afford to give the enemy ground. We just talked about John 10:10. The thief cometh not but to steal, to take, to rob, to break in. He comes in to take, and he comes in to kill, annihilate, utterly destroy. He comes to destroy, but Jesus said he came that we may have life, vitality, refreshing, joy, peace, comfort, anointing, breakthrough, flourishing, surplus. He came that we may live and have our very being on the inside of him. He came that we may have life. Amen. And so the next scripture, James 3:16, this is reminding us that when there's envying and strife, there's confusion in every evil work. So when you're in a place where it seems like you're fighting against a person, you might want to see whether or not it's strifing. My husband and I, we were in a place of just as married couples or something. It wasn't even anything big, but I saw the assignment of strife, and I'm sure he did too. But the Holy Spirit just gave me wisdom. I mean, I didn't even think about it. I just went over to him, and I just touched him, and I said, honey, you know what? I don't want to fight. I know you don't want to fight either. You're not my enemy. And I just touched him, and he just mellowed. Because it was a strife that was trying to come between us, and we were not going to allow that strife, that assignment, to overtake our home, our relationship. We had been out shopping and enjoyed ourselves, and so I was like, I see that this is strife. Not saying that there isn't any truth to the conversation we're having, but it's like, no. So when there's strife, you have to understand it's an evil work that's trying to bring about confusion. Don't yield to it. Amen. And so the next scripture, 1 Peter 5:8, talking about being sober. So many people are intoxicated and drunk. And like I said, when you're drunk, you're kind of defenseless, you know, especially if you're sloppy drunk. You don't even know where you're at. You don't know what's being done to you. So the scripture says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, that wicked one, is as a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. And this is a strategy in this battle, in this war. Psalms 141:3. Set a watch, O Lord, before my mouth, and keep the doors of my lips. And so that's a strategy. We talked about that. Silencing. Zip. You don't have to always say anything. So set a watch over what you say. Think about what you're going to say. Does it have to be said? Do you have to just get to understand there is strength and quietness sometimes? And so we have to understand that. 2 Corinthians 10:5. cast down every high thing that exalts itself above against the knowledge of God, and bring it into captivity. When you are in a place of fighting and war, you want to have some spoils, and you want to bring about your enemy into a place of captivity. Those thoughts that are at enmity with and against God, bring those thoughts into a place of binding that stronghold so it does not have a place of operating. Come into fruition what you meditate on as a man thinketh. So we have to understand, cast down those thoughts. Cast them down, because they have no business trying to exalt themselves above Jesus Christ. Amen. Galatians 5, 22 through 24. This is how we advance the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit, or the subtle weapons of the Spirit in this war, are love, patient, kind, does not keep a record of wrongdoings. The fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and serving the Lord with gladness. The fruit of the Spirit is peace and shalom and comfort. The fruit of the Spirit is long-suffering, being patient and gentle, kind, good, faithful, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And then in this fight, and in this place of where the enemy will try to come in and bring about a charge or a process, have a accusation, when you are in the place of operating the fruits of the Spirit, there is no law that can be loosed against you. Amen. Because we respond to the higher court and the higher law of the kingdom of God. So the fruits of the Spirit in operation will cause us to be protected. It will cause us not to be judged. Hallelujah. Two more scriptures before we're finished. James 1, verses 14 through 15, talking about everybody being tempted, but you don't have to fall. God, I love this. He creates a way of escape for us. There's always a way to run out of a situation. Going back to the story, I think it was Joseph, and it was Potiphar's wife who was trying to come on to him. He ran from her because he was like, I can't be with you. You know, your husband put me in position. And so he knew that we have to flee and run from some things if it's going to catch us up. So we have to be, when we're tempted, we don't have to follow through with what the temptation is wooing and beckoning us to do. Amen. We don't have to yield to it. Amen. And if you do, repent, wash yourself off. There's grace for that. But the key is to stay in the battle, to stay in the fight, to understand the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God. The key is to yield, to submit, to yield unto the kingdom of light. Amen. And our last scripture tonight, 1 Corinthians 14:33. For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints. And so in the body of Christ, in your local church, we have to understand, if there's some confusion and strife, God is not author of that. Who authored it? Who wrote the chapter of that confusion? The enemy. So we have to understand, we cannot allow him to come in and cause. God says, I hate those who cause division and discord among the brethren. So in the body, in our relationships, in our home, in our marriages, we cannot allow confusion or every evil work or strife to manifest its ugly head. We have to cast it off. We have to cut it off at the root. Amen. And I'm going to share this last scripture. It's the scripture we started out with. Romans 6 and 16. Know that in this battle, because yes, you're in a battle, whether you like it or not, but you're going to like the spoils. You're going to like being able to take the enemy and make an open spectacle of him. You're going to like being victorious. In this battle that we're fighting, which is not flesh and blood, but it's against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places, the devil and his kingdom, adversary who is roaring about, even in 2020, in this battle, know that we can't afford to strengthen the wolf called the devil. We have to understand that our strategy, our weaponry in this battle is to know that what we yield ourselves to, we are obeying and servants to obey. And so we have to understand, we're not to yield to sin and death, but we are to yield unto obedience and unto righteousness. And so I hope that something I said bless you on tonight. Remember, we're in a battle, we're in a war, but it's a fixed fight. And so we have to just fight with wisdom, with meekness, kindness, strategy, yielding and submitting to the things of God and the kingdom of God. So God bless you. We hope to see you back here on Sunday morning. And remember, he's as a lion. He's not a lion. Let the lion of the tribe of Judah roar. Be blessed, and we'll see you next time. God bless you.